Is that better? Excellent. Well, good morning or good afternoon, depending on where you are in the country. My name is Jerry Roche. I'm with the Federal Highway Administration in the Office of Safety out of headquarters. I actually just started in my current position in June, so it's been kind of a whirlwind tour. The first thing they told me I was going to work on was the EDC initiative. So thank you for joining us for the data-driven safety analysis presentation. We're going to talk about integrating safety performance into all highway investment decisions today. So we've got a good number of folks in our audience, and we also have a lot of folks online, so thanks for tuning in. I do want to introduce our team very briefly here. Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Will Stein. I'm the safety engineer with FHWA Minnesota's division.
Hi, everyone. John McFadden. I'm with Federal Highway Administration's Resource Center out of Baltimore.
Thanks, John, and thanks, Will. They're going to talk to you a little bit later today. I'm going to start us off this morning. And as I said, I'm new to Office of Safety. Before that, I was in the division office in Iowa for about 13 years doing safety and traffic operations responsibilities, and also worked part-time for the Resource Center at that time, too. So what we've got to share with you today is a lot of material on data-driven safety analysis, but the slides are provided to you. Of course, online, we have the presentation. We also have it on your thumb drive today. So if we don't get through all of our slides, that's not important to us. What we do want to talk about is things that are important to you. So if you have questions, feel free to interrupt us at any time and ask those questions. We want to talk about what you guys are interested in. So so to kind of help us out, it'd be helpful if you guys could introduce yourselves. Tell us your name and the agency you're with, your position or the responsibilities that you have in your position. Briefly, if you could, one way your agency has incorporated safety analysis into your decisions. And then also what you'd like to learn more about today. So why don't we go around, we'll start on this side here.
Good afternoon, my name is Rob Limoges. I'm with New York State DOT. I'm currently the director of our Safety Program Management Bureau. Our agency has recently done a lot of work on our capital program development. And one of the ways that we've used safety analysis is to develop a set of criteria that we use for a competitive-based process to award HSIP projects on and off system. And I guess I'd like to learn more about what the rest of the country is doing to implement the Highway Safety Manual.
Excellent. We will certainly talk a little bit about some of that. And as other folks have information, feel free to share it as we go. So thank you. That's great.
Hello, my name is Joe Willett, and I'm from the Connecticut Department of Transportation. I am the state safety engineer. What I'd like to learn most about today is some different techniques for safety analysis other than the safety analysis AstroWare program. See what other programs are out there, other ways we can do business.
Okay, for safety management. Okay, we can talk a little bit about that then for sure.
Hi, Colin Bomber from Connecticut DOT. I work with Joe, and I'd be interested in looking at systemic safety and figuring out the best type of analyst you can find to come up with different systemic type projects.
Sure. Okay. We're going to hear about that for sure.
Hi, I'm Sean Raymond. I'm the HSIP program manager for the Rhode Island DOT. We've incorporated a lot into our safety analysis. We're starting to collect the MIR elements, and we're looking at safety analysts. So, you know, one thing I'd like to learn a lot more about is opportunities for training that could be available to us.
Very good. We'll certainly talk about that. We don't get into a lot of detail on safety analysts in here because, you know, we could get into a lot of weeds and a lot of these things, but we certainly will talk about that, and we could certainly talk afterwards about some of the resources out there.
Hi, I'm Peter Pavo, VHB, a consultant for RIDOT on the safety analysis. We help them run their HSIP program. So, you know, kind of ties in with Sean and his needs with the MIR and safety analyst. But also, I guess just general, like, systemic projects, how other states do it with if they have a lack of data.
Sure.
Like, how do they do something maybe whole, you know, without that available data?
Sure. We actually have a whole class on doing safety analysis in a data-limited environment, so we might talk a little bit about that too.
I'm Michelle Marshall. I'm from New Hampshire DOT. I'm the highway safety engineer. We have incorporated a safety analyst into our decision making, and I'd like to learn more about the systematic as well as how to implement the highway safety manual more into our projects.
Perfect.
Hello, my name is Kevin Marsh. I'm with the Vermont Agency of Transportation. I'm the Deputy Chief Engineer. We're looking more and more at kind of those programmatic type approaches to safety and how we're incorporating more broadly, you know, crashes and crash data into what we're doing across our network. One of the things I was hoping to learn a little bit more today is just how other states are looking at incorporating not just the infrastructure piece, but when you look at a strategic highway safety plan and the 4E's of highway safety, how they're incorporating different modes into their funding decisions as well.
Perfect. Yeah, there's a lot going on in that area. Just kind of getting going. So,
I'm John Porbay with Construction Industries Massachusetts, and I'm here just to learn a little bit about the program.
Perfect.
Hi, I'm Frank DiPolo, Secretary of Transportation for the state of Massachusetts. We're evolving into a more metric-driven, performance-based project selection criteria, and I'm looking to get input on the best practices of incorporating safety into that investment decision.
Great. That's exactly what we're going to talk about.
Hi, Randy Ditburner with the Virginia DOT. I'm a little bit out of my element here, out of the mid-Atlantic, so I think one way we can really improve safety, for me at least, is to try to all work together to keep the snow from happening. So if I could ask for your help with that. The Highway Safety Manual isn't so new anymore, but in Virginia we are really working hard to try to implement that as much as we can, take advantage of that research to guide our investment decisions. So that's been a huge help for us. And I'd like to learn a little more about the state of the practice on that.
Excellent. Thanks, Randy. And Randy will be speaking, I assume, at the data-driven or the road diets later today. So if you haven't seen that session, that's also being broadcast live today. So I'd highly encourage it. This analysis can actually help you with your road diet selection. So,
hi, everyone. I'm Donna Shea. I'm the director of Connecticut's LTAP Center, and happy to welcome Virginia as an adopted member of New England now. We're in Connecticut, over the last few years, we've been very fortunate to be able to implement a new safety circuit rider program and a crash data repository and have all these great tools. So now we really want to help local agencies engage in really comprehensive safety analysis. So look forward to that.
Perfect. I think we have some things, particularly from Minnesota, that we'll share about how that could possibly work.
Joyce Taylor, I'm the chief engineer for Maine DOT. I'm relatively new to my position, a year. It seems new still. One of the things that we've done recently is been able to institute more frequently the use of centerline rumble strips, and we actually have been able to get the public to really demand them so that we're making sure that they're pushing and we have a positive reinforcement, but we're using the safety analysis for people who want to go maybe 40 straight miles to try and pick those locations, and that's been very helpful. I am glad to see you here because one of my big questions is this whole question of road diet and complete streets. I have lots and lots of people now who are not engineers trying to get us to take out traffic lights everywhere and in the name of road safety. And there's, I think, a lot going on that's really good in terms of the different modes and what people desire, but kind of trying to figure out how other states are managing that conversation around safety and what's safe versus not. And
great. We will definitely touch on that. And I think that would be a fruitful discussion as we get into
something. Steve Landry, I'm the work for Maine DOT, state traffic engineer. We use the safety analysis in developing our HSIP. One of the things that we do spend part of our safety money on is more proactive type treatments to prevent things from becoming issues and how that's dealt with when you're dealing with data-driven analysis for coming up with projects. Because I think there's an element of safety there for those kind of things, but it's hard to quantify the safety impacts.
Yeah. We'll have Jennifer introduce herself as well.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Fenwick. I'm with Applied Research Associates, and I'm helping this team with their implementation plan, so I'm taking notes today.
Thanks for being here, Jennifer.
It's good to be here, Jerry.
Very good, very good. We'll kind of get into this. We're going to begin with an overview today. At that point, then we'll also talk about some methodologies and case studies. I'll turn it over to John McFadden for that piece. And then also state experiences. We're going to hear quite a bit from Minnesota on the systemic approach. And then also we're going to hear about Louisiana's approach to the predictive analysis side. Now, we've had two young ladies that have been helping us out on the predictive side from Louisiana, one from the division office and one from the Department of Transportation and Development. but neither could be here today. So I'm going to try and pinch hit for them and do the best I can. I've heard it 6 times now, so I think I can handle it. But and then we'll finish up just with some resources as well. So, so what is the Data-Driven Safety Analysis Initiative? It's really the application of two science-based analysis approaches. The systemic approach, which you heard several folks mention, and then also the predictive approach. We'll touch on both of those. Into two common transportation processes. Of course, the first is safety management. Now, it's probably not too much of a stretch to understand why we want safety analysis incorporated into your safety management process. But the other is project development. We think there's a lot of opportunities to increase the amount of analysis you're doing in all your highway investment decisions, and we're going to touch on that as we go along today. So. Why do we get involved in the Data-Driven Safety Analysis Initiative as an EDC3 initiative? This actually was one of the ones that came over from AASHTO. AASHTO was putting this forward as one that they thought should be carried forward, and of course Federal Highway was certainly supportive. This information here comes from FHWA State Data Capabilities Assessment that was done back in 2012. And these are the findings that we had from that, that research. So the use of data analysis varies from state to state. I think we all know that. All states are interested in improving their data capabilities, and I think we've seen a lot since 2012 improvements in that areas. States were excited about implementing the Highway Safety Manual, and many of you mentioned that you're in that process now. And then also that they saw the Highway Safety Manual as a major advance to the safety profession. So the thing I didn't put on the slide is that the states welcomed FHWA's participation in helping advance the state of the practice, and so this was really a no-brainer for us. So. What is our key message? Well, it's fairly simple and straightforward. More informed decision-making will lead to better targeted investments, which will result in fewer fatalities and serious injuries on our roadways. So just to give you some of the terminology here, the systemic analysis, we're talking about a system-wide screening of your roadway network, looking for the presence of high-risk roadway features. You see some here on the slide. Really, this is just kind of an analysis, a sieve analysis, if you will, showing some of the features that you might want to look at or characteristics that might tell you where you're having high crash problems. And so as we'll talk more about and we get into the details here, sometimes it looks like these things might be happening randomly. You have crashes that happen and maybe you can't figure out a rhyme or reason to it. Well, there's probably circumstances that are very similar at all those crashes, and we can start teasing those out of the data systems to figure out where we might make some improvements. And we'll talk more about that as we go along. So, I've heard folks too on the project development side say, well, we've got these things happening, but it doesn't look like it's a big problem. Well, have we looked at it systemically? And so we'll touch on that as we go here. So the systemic analysis is particularly useful in those states that have a high percentage of rural roadway mileage or local roadway mileage. We think this can be very useful in those things. It can also help with specific crash types. And so one that's gotten a lot of interest lately is the pedestrian crashes. And so we'll maybe see how that could apply to that situation. So it really supplements your traditional site analysis. It doesn't replace that necessarily. And it may include treating locations that haven't yet experienced many crashes. And that's really a paradigm shift for some folks. It's really hard for folks to wrap their arms around some of that. Why are we improving this curve here that hasn't had any crashes while we're ignoring locations that have had crashes? And we'll touch on that and how that really works as we go along. On the predictive side of things, we're talking about using crash, roadway, and traffic volume data to estimate the expected safety performance. And we talk about safety performance, we're usually talking about crash frequency and crash severity, and really helping quantify those safety impacts. Now you think about how we've done that in the other areas. For many, many years, we've done that in things such as traffic growth, environmental impacts, pavement life, construction costs. We've been estimating those things for quite a while. Finally, safety has a voice and a seat at that table to just be part of that discussion. So we're going to talk about that. And as you heard, I think Randy mentioned, the Highway Safety Manual was out there. And really, a lot of our predictive analysis got summed up in the Highway Safety Manual. The Highway Safety Manual was over a 10-year effort to produce the first manual that was published in 2010. They actually have crash modification factors that were considered for that publication that go clear back to 1945. So that's based on decades upon decades of research and sound research. So it's maybe a little bit different that we're predicting crashes, but it's really based on a lot of sound science that's been done. So and really, the Highway Safety Manual is based on equations. So we'll talk about those, the safety performance functions. There's spreadsheets that have been developed from those equations. There's also very many software products that are out there, some that were developed by Federal Highway Administration, some under collective collaborative efforts, and also commercial products, and even state-developed products. So we'll also touch on the Crash Modification Factors Clearinghouse. And as I mentioned, the Highway Safety Manual was published in 2010, but we have some brand new chapters on freeways and interchanges that actually are just being printed as we speak, and maybe you've seen something recently about pre-ordering those copies. So some very new information. We'll touch on some of those analysis tools based on those new research. So even though it's not printed yet, we're already using that research in our analysis tools. So, and we have to throw something in there, especially this time of year. You know, we just had the World Series that concluded here in November, but also with all the snow that's happened across the Mid-Atlantic and the Michigan area in particular, we thought we had to make this a little bit fun. So bear with us. We're going to show a video here. As I talked about EDC, it really helps us bring a lot of resources to the table that otherwise wouldn't be there. And one of the things that we were able to do was fund our own movie trailer. So. Uh-oh. Yeah, we'll try that again here. Did we lose our sound again? Yeah. I hate to mess with that too much.
I need more money.
We're not New York.
Fine players with the money that we do have.
I like Perez.
Got an ugly girlfriend. Ugly girlfriend means no confidence.
You guys are talking the same old nonsense, like we're looking for Fabio. We got to think differently.
Who's Fabio?
Your goal shouldn't be to buy players. Your goal should be to buy wins.
We're gonna shake things up. Why don't you walk me through the board?
I believe there's a championship team that we could afford because everyone else undervalues them, like an island of misfit toys.
We want you at first base.
I've only ever played catcher.
It's not that hard, Scott. Tell him, Wash.
It's incredibly hard.
He can't throw.
But what can he do?
You want me to speak?
We're not pointing you yet.
He gets on base.
We are card count. I'm heading in. Text me the play-by-play.
Wait, what?
I don't watch the games.
Billy Beane has tried to reinvent a system that's been working for years. There was a nice theory, just not working out.
How long is Billy Beane gonna last?
He's proven himself right out of a job.
In their minds, it's threatening the game. Threatening the way that they do things.
Hey, Daddy, do you think you'll lose your job?
What? Where'd you hear that?
Well, I go on the internet sometimes.
Don't go on the internet. Watch TV or talk to people. You're discounting what scouts have done for 150 years?
What the hell am I doing?
What is happening at Oakland?
It defies everything we know about baseball.
Just plain crazy!
If we win with this team, we'll change the game.
This better work. I'm just kidding you.
Well, hopefully you could hear that. It was a little quiet on our end, but if you were paying close attention, you might have heard a few things there that that really resonate, I think, with what we're talking about today. So. He talked about had to do things differently. And for those that are familiar with the story or read the book or seen the movie before, it's really about general manager Billy Beane. And he was trying to compete with the New York Yankees. At the time, his budget was around $41 million. The New York Yankees' budget was $121 million. So he couldn't do things the same way. He couldn't play the same game as they were. And so he came up with a system that basically was based on base percentage and getting runs that way. And so at the time, as you saw in the trailer, you know, that was really a junk science and really challenged how scouts looked at players and how he was going to do things. And but it worked. He was able to make the playoffs with that roster and really changed the game, literally changed the game. And now almost every professional sports team has at least one quantitative analyst on their staff. So Really, you know, you think about our game in looking at safety projects or maybe even highway investments in general, we probably haven't changed our HSIP program for the last 10, maybe 20 years on how we do those projects. If you think about capital improvement projects, we probably are still doing those the same way we did back in the interstate construction days. We really haven't changed those processes. And so we think there is more quantitative safety analysis that we can do on our investment projects, not just safety projects, but all projects to improve those decisions that we're making. So how many states are looking at practical design? We're going to touch on some of that too and how that might fit into what we're talking about. So, of course, in our line of business, we're not trying to run the pennant or anything. We're actually trying to reduce those unnecessary tragedies that are happening on our roadways each and every day. So, kind of an awesome responsibility. So, here it just shows the transportation processes that we're talking about. And these might look a little bit different in your state, but they're probably similar to this. You see safety management on the left and then also project development. And these arrows indicate where we think these analysis tools can be inserted into your process to help you make better investment decisions. Does that mean always doing more for safety? No, it might mean doing less for safety. We think, particularly if you're looking at practical design, there's opportunities where you might be able to reduce the cost of your project while not adversely impacting safety. And so we'll talk more about that as we go. So just a couple illustrations that kind of touch on what we're talking about here. This happens to be three different alternatives. You see here a no-build alternative, then alternatives one and two. So to the naked eye, those might seem like the same, and especially the traveling public. They might not even see much of a difference in these design options. Well, we know they all should mention too, they all meet current design standards. So they're certainly allowed to be built, I guess, if you want to say it that way. But the predictive analysis tells us that they're going to perform very differently. In fact, alternative two would reduce the fatal and injury crashes by over 60% each year. And so these tools can become powerful. It helps us help ourselves understand these better, might help us convince our management of what decision we should make. Might also be something you could take to the public and help them make the right investment decisions. So elected officials can also be influenced by these tools. So it really helps give them a true picture of what might be happening out there. Just a systemic illustration. A few years ago, a lot of agencies were installing cable median barriers for the interstate systems. Well, you could do that just by your fatal crash data alone, and you know, certainly that's something that could have been done. But many states used other characteristics, other roadway characteristics, to help make those decisions. So how many folks in here have done that with cable median barrier? We've got some here. What other things did you guys include in your analysis? Did you... Yeah, median width. Great. Yeah. Excellent. So you looked at other locations that maybe not yet has a problem, but has similar median width and decided to put it in there proactively. It's great. Anything else you guys used? Other characteristics or conditions? So widths was, I think predominantly that was the main one. Speeds. Okay. Yeah. Speeds. Another one I've heard. Yeah. Okay, other divided highways that had speeds. Some folks too have used traffic volume. They figured, you know what, you know, okay, someone crosses, what's the opportunity of hitting an oncoming vehicle? And so that's been something. Also, a lot of the research has shown too the access points. You know, if you've got interchange, merge, and diverge points, that's another point where folks kind of get out of control and have a chance to go across. So back where I'm from, you know, curvilinear alignment and certainly weather, you know, plays a part. We have certain areas that snow is notoriously drifts across the road. Those are other locations we looked at too. So good, that's a good example. So just one more example. How many folks know who Warren Buffett is? Yeah, he's doing okay for himself, isn't he? Yeah, he's outpaced the S&P 500 by 8 percentage points. And his stock that began at $100 is now worth over $200,000 per share. So old Warren's doing okay. The thing that might surprise you about Warren Buffett is he doesn't just do the same old thing that he's done. And we talked about that in our programs. But he's always constantly looking at his investments to figure out where he can maximize that return on investment. And again, I think we could do a little bit more of that and collectively in our analysis of our investments. So just some early states that have done some of these. I want to share some quotes, I guess, from states that have elected to do quantitative safety analysis and what they've seen from it. So the first one comes from Colorado. Deployment of advanced methods on all projects and acquisition of high-quality data may explain why Colorado has outperformed the rest of the country in reduction in fatal crashes. From Illinois, use of these methods requires additional roadway data, but has improved the sophistication of safety analyses in Illinois, resulting in better decisions to allocate limited safety resources. and from Ohio. Now several screening methods can be used in the network screening process. These higher identification rates indicate much more accurate identification of problem locations. So we can go through this fairly quickly. Again, collectively, it helps identify factors that contribute to crashes and also come up with mitigation strategies. Helps us identify the sites with the potential for crash reduction. We talk about potential for safety improvement, or PSI, and John's going to touch more on that as we go. Helps us estimate the potential effect on crash frequency and severity for those planning, design, operations, and policy decisions that we might be looking at. It helps us evaluate the crash reduction benefits of the implemented treatments. So after the fact, we can see, are we getting what we thought we were going to get? So our EDC vision, as I mentioned before, that safety performance is integrated into all highway investment decisions. And our mission, basically a longer way to say the same thing, to broaden implementation of quantitative safety analysis so that it becomes an integral component of safety management and project development decision making, resulting in fewer fatal and serious injury crashes on our nation's roadways. So I included some information here on strategic plans. We've got some from AASHTO here. We've got the Strategic Highway Safety Plan that talked about improving information and decision support systems. I've got one on promoting accountability through performance-based management. And someone mentioned that that's a growing area is looking at performance-based systems. Also, the strategic plan talked about institutionalization and further development of the Highway Safety Manual. Also, being able to quantify the changes in safety performance that we could get from our projects. So, looking at FHWA Safety Strategic Plan, 3.1 talks about improving safety data and expanding our capability for analysis and evaluation. Again, getting into further into the weeds, we get into our Strategic Implementation Plan, talks about using evidence-based analysis tools, including the Highway Safety Manual and the systemic tool for safety on all public roads. And so what I wanted to kind of paint the picture with those is that, you know, this isn't a flash in the pan. This isn't the flavor of the month. Data-driven safety analysis has been going on for some time now, and it's going to continue to go on. So I think the real advantage to us of being an EDC initiative is it helps us give it a shot in the arm. It gets maybe more attention from our top-level management. Also gives us some funding support. There are some things that we can help with resources to help your agency take that next step forward, and we're going to talk mostly the rest of the day about that. So just through some information here about lead state and also the pooled fund states that are out there, a lot of states have been involved in this effort, including a few in this region. So there is a lot going on in this area. Same thing with training. This shows training that FHWA has conducted. So some agencies have done their own training, but there has been quite a few workshops that have been held. This talks about the systemic safety improvements. Now this comes from our 2013 HSIP report. So we haven't looked at the 2014 reports yet this year, but many states are suspending some of their HSIP funds for systemic improvements. So the dark green states where it's known, we've included the percentage of funds that have been spent on that. And I'd say, you know, I'd ask you to look at that and see if that's the right balance. There's no right answer for that. That completely depends on the state, based on your percentage of state versus local roads, based on the proactive versus reactive improvements that are necessary for your state. So, but look at that. See if it's the right balance for your state. So there's been a systemic safety peer exchange, and there's one coming up later this month in Columbus, Ohio, that some of the states here will be involved in. There's more opportunities for these. So if you're interested in that, let us know. So this is actually bringing together states that have started to look into the systemic approach and get them all together. So if you have questions, we can certainly talk about that. So, but there's more opportunities. So if your state's not on there and you're interested in that, let us know, and we are looking to set up. Sure.
I noticed Rhode Island at 20%. From us. It's just a misleading number because our systemic stuff is so low cost.
Sure.
So the percentage of allocation of funds, we had like maybe two large projects that took a lot, 80% of the funding, but we covered a lot more through systemic, even though it was low because it was like rumble strips or siding.
Very good point. And I always like to point out too that our whole safety program is not our HSIP pot. You know, some of these folks, you know, as you do resurfacing projects, they may do rumble strips or paved shoulders, things like that, and you're probably doing that with resurfacing dollars rather than safety dollars. So there's a lot of safety things going on that might not be captured on. This is just one way to maybe show some of that as an indicator. So absolutely, good point. Thank you for showing that. So, and just to finish up with some opportunities I think that might be out there. On the safety management side, as I just mentioned, you know, having a data-driven, balanced statewide safety program, whatever makes the most sense for your agency, and we can help you with that analysis if you'd like. We also think as your state looks at performance measures, and that's out there right now, these tools can help you make a balanced approach that's really a good safety target. Rather than just picking a number out of the sky, let's use these analysis tools to figure out where we might be able to get to based on our investment decisions. So,
Where's the data coming from, and who's, unlike severity, who's grading it? How is that determined?
You're talking about for the analysis or prediction side of things?
Yeah.
We're gonna talk more about that in the methodology section, but so John will get to that, but just to steal a little bit of it, it depends on the different approach. Two-lane rural highways is different data sources than maybe intersections would be. Same thing with the interchanges and freeway sections. Those are different states in some specs. So we tried to use the best, certainly had to be available, and then also the best data we could to figure that out. And you're going to touch on that, I assume. So,
yeah, I would also say that
just a second.
In cases where you don't have data available to you, these tools allow us to use some default distributions. And there are a few critical data elements that are necessary, for instance, the exposure metrics, AADT on the road. But if you don't have actual counts, again, there's ways that we can work around that. And so this is, and I'll talk about this a little further.
Great question. Keep those coming. So. Also on the project development side, I just cited four areas I think that maybe are out there as new opportunities. I think NEPA documents is something, as we go through an alternatives analysis, I think that's maybe an area that we can do a lot more on, especially if safety is included in the purpose and need. You know, I think sometimes safety gets put in there like motherhood and apple pie, and sometimes we don't ever put a lot in that section. So I think that's something that might be an area you can do more of, particularly now that we've got these freeway chapters. I think that maybe there's some opportunities there. Also design exceptions. You know, we have an expanded NHS system there now, and so maybe there's an opportunity you're going to be doing some increased amount of design exceptions. I don't think this is going to necessarily change your design exceptions that you're making, your designers are making, but it might help justify or validate their intuition that they've done in the past. And so I think these help verify and at least have you something that shows what your judgment was and confirms your engineering judgment. Interstate system access change requests is, again, as I mentioned, we know we've got these freeways interchange chapters now. I think that really helps us. Familiar with policy point 3, it requires a safety and operational analysis to be done. So in my job when I was a division person, I would read a lot of those interchange justification reports, and you'd get into it and talk about improving safety. So I'd flip to the safety section and say, well, we're going to improve things operationally, ergo safety will be improved. Well, that's not always the case, and certainly as we look at different configurations, that's not necessarily the case. They don't all operate equally from a safety perspective, and so now we can finally quantify that and use that as part of our decision matrix. And also I mentioned the practical design thing. FHWA always promotes performance-based practical design. So you have to cut 10% from a project. Let's not just take 10% from the easiest parts. Let's actually look at it from a safety analysis and figure out where can we make these cuts to save us some money without adversely impacting safety. If you can save 10% on this project and that helps you further advance another project that maybe needs some safety improvements in it, we're all for that. So I think net benefit is still going to be improved safety. So we'll talk more about that. So any other questions? It's been a good discussion so far. Any questions online? We certainly can entertain those as well. So.
You might cover this in a little bit. I'm just curious of when it comes to applying systemic improvements, where like if you want to put roundabouts systemically and we want to put one where there's no crash data, obviously we can use the CMF, but curious of other, like, and DOT doesn't, RIDOT doesn't have the Meyer in yet, so they can't do the SPF. So curious of how we, in the interim, can get a benefit cost. If that's
Sure. There's a lot of work going on right now. Actually, they've started the work for the second edition of the HSM that is doing some intersection things, and roundabouts is one of the projects that's being funded right now. I'm not sure the status of that, but it will definitely be done before the next manual gets printed. But
table that. When I get up, I'll start doing it.
All right. All right. We'll cover that in John's section. So, John, why don't you go ahead and come up? I think we're doing okay on time so far. So. I can give you 5 minutes. Right, let me.
Quickly to respond, and first let me start by saying Buffett, about 20 years ago, bought Dairy Queen. The reason he initially purchased Dairy Queen was as a kid, he went there and he liked it. I never want to throw that knowledge away. There are things that we know work in our system that are effective at reducing fatal and injury crashes, and that inherent knowledge stays with us. The goal of what we're promoting here is to complement that engineering judgment with some unbiased estimators that allow us to part the gray clouds into clearly black and white issue that quantifies for each project we're working on, the specific design that will yield the biggest return, and then given we have probably 30 or 40 projects all worthy of funding in our jurisdiction, but only have enough money today to fund three, we better be able to pick the three that are going to yield the biggest return if we want to start moving the numbers, because the resources, I don't see in the future a substantial increases in our budgeting and resources available to us to address this. It might be the case, but I am from Philadelphia, so by definition, as a Philly sports fan, I'm a pessimist and a skeptic. And going back to how do we deal with areas or situations where we have limited data availability? We don't have SPFs that are unique to our state. The Highway Safety Manual I'll get into provides the opportunity to adjust these models or calibrate them to reflect what's going on locally. So you can still apply the methodologies here. The other analogy I'll make, this is a big pool of water. You do not have to dive in head first, meaning you can be intimidated. Some locations, states and locals, get intimidated by the amount of data elements necessary to apply the entire methodology. You can stick your toe in this pool first and apply it to smaller projects. A good example of that, Jerry mentioned design exceptions for freeways now. We can analyze safety performance on freeways. So whenever you're doing an IJR or a design exception for a freeway project, if you type in NCHRP 17-45, that is the next chapter 18 and 19 that's going into the Highway Safety Manual, and you can download it for free right now. It'll be in the next edition. But there are opportunities, and in the next 15 to 20 minutes, I can't tell you all of them. But I hope we spike your interest in such a way that you'll come and pursue some of the resources we have to learn more about what we can offer in terms of applying this performance-based analysis approach to basically giving safety a voice in the decision-making process. Okay, so with that as a backdrop, I'll get into the presentation now and try and move along pretty quickly. Some of this is a bit redundant, and I'll try and minimize that. But my first point that I want to discuss is the idea of nominal versus substantive safety. Then I'll get into data-driven safety analysis by looking at both the systemic and the predictive approaches and do a few examples. When we examine safety, we look at it typically from two perspectives. In the past, without the tools that we're promoting here, there was an implicit assumption that by complying with standards, I would expect some safety performance result from the project. It's not guaranteed. So what did we do? Well, we went beyond and looked not just at complying with standards, but the actual safety record of the site by frequency, type, and severity to see, are these numbers acceptable? Now, by no means am I saying any fatal at a location is acceptable, but we have to take a more pragmatic approach to this in recognizing there is risk on every road we have out there. And if you look at on Wall Street, the philosophical approach is we want higher highs and higher lows with our investments. We have the reverse from the perspective of our performance metrics, which are fatal crashes and severe injury crashes. We want lower highs and lower lows. The only way to accomplish that is to systematically, through each investment opportunity we have, isolate and pick the project and design within the project that yields the biggest return. What is that return? Reduction in fatals and injuries. So it's critical. The substantive safety side is a critical element or component to that analysis process. It's the data itself. That nominal, and this is a better illustration. This illustration captures the distinction that's made between nominal safety versus substantive. Nominal safety is that green line. And it's a binary world. Are there any attorneys here? Attorneys love the binary. It's right or it's wrong. It's a very nice place to live when it's true, but rarely in life are the decisions we make that simple. So what we attempt to do and what we now have available to us are tools that quantify the gray, which is that orange slope. It's the substantive safety performance or the crash risk associated with each of the design decisions we make for a project. That knowledge is what was lacking 20, 30 years ago. With that knowledge today, we can apply these performance-based methodology, or we now become more than just highway safety engineers. I call our task, we are financial advisors for the investment of public funds, and we're trying to provide sound financial advice. Okay, I'll jump into safety versus predictive analysis. Both of these use data, crash data, exposure data, roadway data, geometric data. The systemic approach is, as Jerry had mentioned, focus on the presence of risk factors. So we're looking from the roadway and traffic aspects, environmental aspects as well. What factors are we experiencing an overrepresentation of crashes? Which of these factors are linked to that overrepresentation? Whereas the predictive approaches allow us the opportunity to predict the expected safety performance for our different projects and different designs within a project, which is really an effective tool. And the safety manual is, in essence, to safety what the capacity manual is for operations. Ultimately, both provide information and data that can be used to make more informed decisions. And I focus on the aspect of safety, so I'm biased, but we are giving safety a voice now at the decision maker's table, because decision makers' primary metric is finance. Tell me, what is my return on this investment? And we did not have a strong voice without the ability to quantify the expected benefit. First, starting with the systemic approaches, the two tools we're mentioning here are Fed Highways research document, the Systemic Safety Project Selection Tool, as well as USRAP. This systemic project safety selection tool is characterized by the steps illustrated here, identifying your crash types and risk, prioritize your candidate locations, selecting countermeasures, prioritize your projects, make a funding or investment decision, and then at the very end, we want to make sure we do an evaluation. This is an iterative process. Everybody here may remember there was a world before Windows. There was a desk operating system, or DOS world. Then Windows came out in the late 80s. It was a fundamental shift in how we use computers. It opened it up to many users. Windows 1.0, if we compare that to current version of Windows, some may prefer it, but what you would likely see is there are much more tools in the current version. We are at version 1.0 of the Highway Safety Manual. Okay? It is critical for us to evaluate the impact of the projects we select and design to improve upon it. This is a data-driven process, and as we get more data and better quality data, so too will our ability to predict this performance. Here's a quick example of a systemic analysis in New York. They looked at intersection and lane departure crashes. We're going to examine the lane departure crashes here that were overrepresented on the state and county roads. And they cross-referenced that against the AADT for those roadways that were experiencing those crashes. And what they found was that for AADTs between 0 and 3,000 vehicles per day, and 3 to 6,000 vehicles per day, there was a substantial overrepresentation in that about 36.3% of the crashes were occurring on about 28% of the mileage. This is an example of how you're looking and filtering out the data to see what combination of risk factors are linked to these crashes. So, benefits of this systemic safety planning. One of the primary things I say, from a risk management and tort liability perspective, we now have something to defend the decisions we make. In the past, typically you would make a funding decision for a project, and 5 to 10 years later, somebody might come along and say, John, you chose to fund projects A, B, and C. And in fact, DE&F were recommended by us to be funded. And what we've seen is so many injury and fatal crashes occur on sites DE&F. 10 years ago, my defense to that would be, well, it was my engineering judgment that A, B, and C were the appropriate investment decisions. Today, that won't be the case. Today, my reaction to that will be, I didn't choose any sites. I evaluated all of the sites within my jurisdiction to see how they would perform over the life of this investment. And based on that analysis, sites A, B, and C, through the life of this project, will yield the biggest return. The important element to this, inasmuch as we are financial advisors for the investment of public funds, we are not day traders. We don't react to 1 month, 2 day, 5 week trends. We are bond investors. We are looking over a 20 to 30 year project life. And when we apply that systematically across all our projects at the sites that yield the biggest return or have the highest potential for safety improvement, that's when you start to see the same effect that was occurring with Moneyball. The reason that works is over the 162 game season, the numbers will work with you. In the playoffs, it doesn't perform as well, but over the life of a season, it performs very well. The second approach are these predictive approaches that I've been teasing with as well. On the far left is an illustration of a bunch of the research that went into the body of the Highway Safety Manual. Some of this research is available for free. I often go out to local agencies to discuss this, and they don't have enough money to buy a safety manual. And I say, well, it doesn't preclude you from applying the methodologies. On the far right are some tools that were developed that help us apply these methodologies without having to go through the 1,250 pages of text written by researchers, and some would say for researchers. If you ever get a chance to read these three volumes, you may find yourself scratching your head trying to figure out, well, how does this impact me? How does this change the way I do things? Again, I would encourage you, when we go through these tools on the right, they take a lot of that information and put it in a much more user-friendly environment that can be applied very quickly. The Highway Safety Manual is a tool that we use to improve safety analysis. It encourages a science-based approach. It provides us the ability to explicitly predict the expected impact of our decisions on design and treatments on safety. It reduces the guesswork, provides us the ability to apply this performance-based decision-making process. There's four parts to it. Part one is an intro and background. Part two captures kind of your HSIP process, Highway Safety Improvement Program, or Roadway Safety Management process. Part C is the predictive methods, and part D are crash modification factors. I'll get into those. When we look at the supporting tools that were on the far right of that first screen, they are linked to one part of the safety manual. So for instance, for the roadway safety management process, the safety analyst software. For the predictive methods, we have the IHSDM, which is the Interactive Highway Safety Design Model, a CAD-based tool that provides the user the ability to do a diagnostic and policy-based review of designs. You have spreadsheets. These spreadsheets are Excel-based, and I guarantee anybody, if I can pick it up in less than an hour how to apply these methodologies, everybody in this room can do it. And they're free for download. If you go to highwaysafetymanual.org, you can download the spreadsheets. Within an hour, you can be applying some of these methodologies. And they're appropriate for a variety of facility types, including now freeways and interchanges, which is the ISADE, the Interchange Safety Analysis Tool spreadsheets. And then we have the clearinghouse. If you look, the manual was published in 2010. Part D of the manual has a hard copy of a diary of all the crash modification factors, which are basically values that quantify the impact of changing a design element or applying a treatment. What impact will that have on safety? How will it modify safety or the crash performance? Well, since 2010, research is continually going on. So we felt that there was a need, and Fed Highway established and built this website that has all the CMFs that were in the manual, as well as any subsequent CMFs that were developed. So if you're ever looking to see what impact would going from a 10-foot lane to 11-foot lane on a two-lane rural highway have, I would go to the cmfclearinghouse.org, and it'll type in that under the search engine. It'll spit out the expected impact and also lead you to the research report that CMF was based on. Excuse me. So how can we apply this? 5 minutes? I'm good. I mentioned this a little bit already. How can we apply this? Systematically, we can apply this on a couple different levels. If I have 40 projects all worthy of funding, but I can only fund 5, I want to do an evaluation of these projects to see which has the biggest potential for safety improvement by determining what is the expected safety performance and compare that to the actual safety performance of these sites. On a project level, within one specific project, I can look at what is the impact of changing different design elements within that project on safety. We know the cost of constructing these elements. What will be the return on that investment in terms of reduction of crashes? So across those two levels, it really has provided us a tool that allows us to explicitly quantify the expected performance of our decisions on safety. I'll share a couple examples now while I finish up. Here is an example in Monroe County, Illinois. They were looking at horizontal curve reconstruction. What was unique about this site? It was a pretty sharp horizontal curve, about 750-foot radius. And the jurisdiction there, Monroe County, was interested in flattening that out to be about a 1,700-foot radius. There was some resistance from those that were going to be impacted in terms of acquisition of their land, and it was going to end up in a legal battle. So what did they try and do? Well, they tried to come up with some common ground. In order to do so, they had to project what would be the impact of one versus another alternative. And they came up with, I guess, analyzing two different alternatives. The proposed alternative, which was a 1,700-foot radius, and then the revised proposal, which was about 1,050-foot radius. If you see there, the modification factor, if you take 1 minus the modification factor, it gives you the reduction factor. These are complements of each other. That reduction factor tells you the percent reduction by applying this treatment. So for the 1,700-foot radius, you were going to get a 35% reduction in crashes. That yielded a benefit-cost ratio of 14.6 to 1. But you're going to end up in court if you wanted to pursue that. The revised common ground approach was a 1,050-foot radius, which yields a 22% reduction in crashes and a substantial 11.1-to-1 benefit-cost ratio, and it was going to be implemented much quicker. So they chose to go with that. Arizona, another example of applying, in this case, the IHSDM to evaluate different alternatives for a two-lane rural highway, where they were looking at going from 0 to 1 foot shoulders and trying to see, well, do we need to go to 5 foot or 8 foot? In economics, there's always a point of diminishing return on your investment, and they were trying to figure this out. So they wanted to examine to what extent would going from a 5 foot shoulder to an 8 foot shoulder yield a benefit, and is it worth it? So they examined that by using what's shown here as the elements that were examined as a part of the interactive highway safety design model. They predicted the crash performance for the different alternatives, and they found that in actuality, the alternative A, which was the 5 foot shoulder, had a higher benefit to cost ratio, and they chose to go with that investment. And then finally, here in Dublin, Ohio, they were looking at a reconstruction of an interchange, I-270 and US 33. And this interchange was going to change the world. They had visions that this was going to improve safety, address congestion, resolve obsolete geometrics, improve quality of life. It'll enhance fiscal responsibility. This is monumental impact. But now we bring safety to the table and give safety a voice relative to all these other stakeholder values that are being impacted. So we're looking at it from the perspective of safety performance. And we analyzed a few different alternatives using the ISAT-E interchange safety analysis tool to predict the expected impact of each of these alternatives from a safety perspective. When they did that, they examined alternative 8 was going to reduce 320 kill injury A and injury B crashes. that would have saved, over the life of the project, about $89 million in societal costs. And the city of Dublin selected this alternative as the preferred alternative, not just based on the safety analysis, but they included the safety analysis across all the alternatives and considered it when they came to their final decision. In closing here, the goal is to use this additional tools that we have available to us to make more informed decisions to get the biggest return on our investment. That return is linked to reducing injuries and fatals on our roadways. I'll accept any questions. Go ahead. Oh, yeah.
Sorry to keep asking questions. For the IHSDM, if DOT wanted to use it without, just off the shelf, yeah, without any, is it still a benefit to using it, right? Even though it's not, we haven't like specified it to the state. Is it worth it off the shelf without like even calibration factors? Because we try to test case with university to do a calibration, and our state doesn't really fit the model. Maybe just our small state, Rhode Island versus what, so it was tough. So we almost have to develop our state-specific SPFs versus the calibration. So just want to know if that's a waste of time, not a waste of time, yeah, I guess a waste of time to use IHSDM, if it's a good investment, yeah.
The IHSDM is a tool that's comprised of like 6 modules. So within those 6 modules, you have a policy review module, which allows you, it's a CAD-based tool too. So you give me a project, give me the CAD version of it, you upload it into the IHSDM. It'll go through that entire project alignment, and it'll assess, does each specific design element comply with standards? So that's one element. So it's tough for me to say the entire IHSDM is not worthy of an investment. First, it's free. The key, so, I mean, if it doesn't cost any, what is the cost associated with it? It's learning it. How do we apply it and putting it on your machines and allocating time to figuring out to what extent will this benefit us? So the other modules include a crash prediction module, intersection analysis, traffic analysis. So there are diagnostic modules associated with it. Again, I would put my toe in the water. I'd get it first. Apply it to some smaller project that can be quickly implemented to see how it performs for you. That's the advice I give. And as you grow in your knowledge and understanding, this is a long process. I don't see a light switch being turned on and we are fully implemented.
No, and then collecting the Meyer data anyway over the next couple of years, so we'll get there. I just in the interim.
My recommendation is that at the very least start. Yes, exactly.
I think, too, you'd see from the alternatives analysis that you can do, and I don't know how long it's been since you looked at the IHSDM, but they've made significant improvements to it, I think, since the first time I saw it. They just came out with the latest version, I think, in September, and you can do alternatives analysis. You don't need to have, and I don't know if you mentioned it on some of our examples here, but you don't need, if you're looking at alternatives, you don't need to calibrate the tools. You wouldn't want to take it out to the public necessarily, but it would help you figure out which alternative would work the best. Correct. As long as you're looking at the same thing, it's still going to help you figure out which one's going to perform better from a safety perspective. So, and we got a comment here, too.
Yeah, this is Rob from New York. And I guess my question is, we have a pretty robust methodology for our network screening process, reviewing and identifying high accident locations. But I think there's a real opportunity for us to make some use of the predictive methodologies for alternative selection. Is there a way to implement that part of the HSM first, or do you really need to have the other basis covered before you get there?
That's an excellent question. I would say definitely, that's a great example. In fact, that's probably around the country we've seen a lot. Some have started to use it for their safety analysis and level of surface of safety of their projects and things, but very few have done a lot on the project development side. And the last presentation here today is going to be about that, but I think there's a tremendous opportunity there to incorporate these decisions. Again, uncalibrated, I think there's a lot we can do on the project development side for the alternatives. So I'll let John see what he's got.
I agree 100%. I think... one of the experiences I've had in training on many of these tools is we think that we have to invest all our time and energy, and you have to have the Cadillac version to apply it. When I speak of Cadillac version, I'm talking about data sets in place, ready to run it. That's not the case. These tools and methodologies can be applied when you have limitations of resources, of data. I mean, we can still implement these on a piece-by-piece basis. Go ahead.
I would mention, too, we have a lot of training. We have entire classes on IHSDM and also ISAT-E and those kind of things. So we certainly can help through that. We also have a lab at our Turner Fairbanks Research Center that can help you through your analysis as you go through that. So if you're willing to try it, step your toe in the water, we'd be happy to help you through a project. So
I think it's great when you use it to do alternatives against one another, and it's great when the alternative you're looking for comes out as the best, but you had one there with the curve that wasn't the best. So how do you take into account the numbers, and what do they actually mean, and at what cost-benefit ratio or reduction factor is...
Can I take this even one step further? Let me go one step further. Do we place ourselves at any greater risk of liability with the knowledge we have? So for instance, with that example, somebody's going to come back in 5 years and say, John, you sold out. You could have gotten a 1,700-foot radius in there, but you went with 1,050. Why? Defend your decision, because theoretically somebody might say, you just killed three people by now putting in that 1,700-foot radius. How do I defend my decision? Well, at that point, before this project hits the street, I first document all the analysis. And you document why this decision was made with respect to the political climate you were working in. I use the analogy, we are bond investors, not day traders. Are there any elected officials in here or online? One of my concerns that occurs is our elected officials function in a different time element than we do. Their time horizons are a little bit shorter. They have windows of 2, 4, 6 year election cycles, which can conflict at times with a bond investor's an investment approach. So documentation is the first thing. The second is you have to indicate, when I say I chose the 1,050-foot radius over the 1,700-foot radius because the expectation was this was going to litigation and this thing would have been a 750-foot radius for the next 30 years. So I wouldn't be comparing that 1,700 to the 1,050. I'd be comparing that 1,700 or the 1,050 to the 750, and that would be how I would defend that decision. But it's a great point. Did I answer your question?
Partially.
Go ahead, finish it.
I'm not exactly worried about the liability portion of it. I'm worried about at what range of cost-benefit ratio or the change in crashes versus the money expended going to be.
What threshold value?
If you've got a 0.2 difference, yeah, and it's going to cost you another $1 million, you know, is there any guidance? Yes.
Whenever presented with a tough question, if you walk away with anything else, it depends is always the right answer. And where I go with this is it's a really good question, and that each project will have that point of diminishing returns, and based on the jurisdiction's budget, the performance of this project, the political environment, there are so many factors that get into exactly what you're saying that it would be foolish for me to say it's this point. Go ahead.
So I'm the chief engineer, and he has to come to me real life and explain his choices for the capital program, and I'm the highest civil servant, so supposedly I'm not, you know, I don't have the political whims, and that's the balance in our department. That's what I do, so I can help the commissioner. How do I, as chief, what are the questions I'm asking of our folks in terms of where are we getting the most bang for the buck? Where are we going to make a difference?
See, it's very easy for me. This is a great question because it's very easy for me. The world I'm living in with this tool is black and white. I'm putting forward to you, these are the A, B, and C are the three projects that are going to yield the biggest return on my investment over the life of the project. Now, you're also going to have to examine the cost of A, B, and C. With maybe they're a much greater investment than I could do eight other projects at the same value. And you have there's a certain number of combinations and permutations you'll have to go through and examine. And as we grow in our ability to predict, and the computing power we have available to us, we can. That's the vision, is we get to a point where the top, we have 100 projects, And it's the appropriate combination of which projects at which prices will yield the biggest return. But this is a breadcrumb trail. We're moving to that point.
Yeah, I think we got to move on in a minute, but I'll just say quickly, too, I think these tools are helpful. And how many people understand when we say calibration what we're talking about? I think most people in here do. So even without any data, we have these tools that can tell you what we expect would happen from a safety performance. But then if we can calibrate it for your data, that's all the better. So if you have a two-lane rural highway that the system predicts based on volume that the crashes are going to be, let's say two crashes per mile. Well, if your system is really only experiencing one crash per mile, then we can reduce those numbers. That helps calibrate for different drivers around the country, helps for, animal crashes, probably a bigger thing up here, terrain issues, things like that, weather conditions. So that helps us calibrate that. But typically, if your agency has historical crash data, we can actually calibrate it based on your historical crash data. We can look at a site that hasn't yet been built but compare it to other locations and say, well, this is what we've seen in the past. This is what the tool predicts us. We can help try and adjust for some of those differences. So I think what you'll see, too, with the tools as we try it, as John mentioned, maybe you're debating shoulder width. Do we put in a 6-foot shoulder or do we put in a 2-foot shoulder with rumble strips? And what do we predict is going to happen? Then let's see after a couple years and reassess that, constantly evaluate how we're actually performing. And that might help us get to a refined decision. So I think we're doing a lot more than we ever did in the past. I think we're going to start making changes every few years, or we used to make changes every few decades on these kind of safety decisions. So I think you're going to see some of that.
Take over.
Okay. Any other questions before we move on to Will? I think Will's going to give us an excellent example of where they've really embraced the systemic improvement. I don't want to steal his thunder, but I think what they've done, particularly with the locals, is going to be pretty interesting, you folks.
We'll get this on.
Very good.
Yeah, and I heard as we're doing introductions, there's quite a few HSIP program managers in the room, which is good. And I also heard a few comments about how to handle the local system, the safety challenges on the local system. So I think for you folks, some of this information from Minnesota may be interesting and some things to consider. The first thing I just want to say is Minnesota's HSIP and safety program is kind of unique because a large portion, I would say well over 50%, is actually targeted towards systemic improvements. And I just want to give you a little history about how we got there, how did Minnesota embrace the systemic approach. And the first thing I'd say is it really takes a change in mindset that needs to occur over time. For a long time, we've just kind of been treating a lot of spot locations, high crash locations, and doing these lower cost improvements spread out more broadly over the system at high-risk locations is kind of a change in mindset that needs to occur amongst a large number of people, actually. And it's taken a sustained effort over time, so it's not something you can really accomplish overnight or with the flip of a switch. Having some key champions and influencers and educators is really important, and I think in Minnesota what really helped us is that those were at various agencies, Federal Highway, the Minnesota DOT. We had some very forward-looking county and city engineers that understood and bought into that approach. So having those champions has been a key part of our change in mindset. And then just a hard look at the data made several things very clear for us. First one being only treating high crash locations or spot locations was not going to achieve the types of crash reduction goals that we had in Minnesota, and I've got some graphics and examples that'll clarify this a little bit for you. And also, only especially in our state, only treating the state system was not going to achieve the goals that we wanted to achieve. And finally, it's an ongoing educational process. This change in mindset. Some folks are still going to be skeptical, just like the scouts in Moneyball were skeptical. So not everyone will come on board at the same time, and that's just something to accept. And kind of where this change in mindset, I guess, was formalized in Minnesota, the first place where I saw it formalized was in our 2007 Strategic Highway Safety Plan. And we set some targets in this plan. So this is looking at state DOT highways now. So for the districts outside of the Twin Cities metro area, we saw a very common problem, severe crashes widely scattered across rural highways outside of the metro area. So we set this target that we wanted it to shoot for 70% systemic projects and set aside about 30% for those spot locations, okay? And then in the metro district, the Twin Cities area, those targets were basically flipped. You know, we've got much higher crash densities in the Twin Cities, more spot location problems. So the target was just switched. 70% for high crash locations and 30% for systemic types of projects. So another change of mindset was that the local system really needed to be addressed. And I've got a couple bar graphs that should make that glaringly obvious, but I guess if you run into resistance in your state, and I don't know how much of in your states the DOT has jurisdiction over versus the locals, but the stated purpose of the Highway Safety Improvement Program is to reduce fatal and serious injuries on all public roads, not just the state DOT system. So it's something that we really emphasize in Minnesota, and you'll see why in a minute. This is a look at our severe crashes in our state, excuse me, and so this includes fatal crashes and serious or A injury crashes, and about 40% of those occur on the state DOT owned system, and about 60% of those occur on the local system in our state. So you can see we've got a pretty significant issue on the local system. And then this was a really important change that went along with this too, was how to fund that problem. So what we strive to do in Minnesota is try to align our HSAP and other safety funding with that same sort of distribution of crashes. So we try to align that as much as we can and fund HSAP projects on the local system. So how can states embrace this systemic approach? The first thing I would look at is check your projects against your data. Are you mostly funding high-cost projects, high crash locations? And at the same time, do you have a lot of severe crashes that are widely scattered across rural and local highways? And if the answer to those two questions are yes, then I think you've got a really big opportunity with this systemic approach to make some significant progress. Help influence and educate, use data to make your case. Make sure the local system is addressed. Like I said, that push for sharing of funds, you know, is a big issue and it's a big obstacle in a lot of states, I know, because there's a lot of needs on the state DOT system. But you really gotta strive, I think, to look at the big picture, and it may take some effort and some advocating on your side to get people to see that bigger picture. And help educate local agencies on the federal process and requirements. That's another obstacle that's often cited. And the way I'd say we overcame it in Minnesota, or are overcoming it, is I think it's important for that change in mindset to occur first, and then these obstacles that you will encounter, whether it be sharing funds or dealing with the more complex federal process, those are tactical things that you can work at over time, but it's that change in mindset that I think is the critical first step. Any questions or comments before I kind of go through a case study as to how we applied this in the state? All right, I'm gonna just focus a little bit here on the northeast corner of Minnesota. And let me see, let's just look up here at Itasca County. This is 5 years of severe crash data, so I'm talking again about fatal and serious injury crashes. You can kind of see the numbers over a 5-year period, only about the black number is actually both state and local highways. So just about 20 per year of those severe crashes, and then on the county system, only about 7 per year. So you can see there's a relatively low number in that they're very much scattered. You can see the amount of mileage on the local system, about 45,000 miles of county road in our state, and very low crash densities. So you've got these severe crashes that are widely scattered across the system. And just looking at it in a different way, You can just see sort of graphically how those severe crashes are scattered throughout the system. But as Jerry mentioned, that doesn't mean they're necessarily random. There's certain characteristics, whether it's horizontal curvature or a lot of other things, that make certain locations at much higher risk. And those are the ones that we're targeting for treatment. And so this has really changed also the types of projects that we're funding with our HSIP program. A lot fewer high-cost spot location intersection types of projects. We do an awful lot of edge treatments, whether that's shoulder rumble strips, enhanced pavement markings, anything we can do to try to keep people on the road. This one I kind of like at a curve. On some of these county roads, there's not a lot of top width, but there's enough oftentimes where we can add a little bit of a 2-foot paved shoulder there, put the safety edge on, put a rumble strip out on that edge. And that's, I think, a good strategy. Curve delineation, another one. And then we also use this at intersections as well. It's a little bit trickier, I guess, but we look at intersection lighting, upgrading the pavement markings and the signing at intersections, at these higher risk intersections. And even some that are a bit higher cost, like J-turn or restricted crossing U-turn intersections. We've got 8 of those built in Minnesota now, but we've got a problem at those types of locations in Minnesota. And but even with things like that, they're a little bit higher cost. If you know what those risk characteristics are along an expressway, you know you can systemically treat those at those high risk locations for much lower cost than an interchange or. And this is the way we went about this process in Minnesota. Once we had the funding straightened out, is the next kind of challenge was how to get good projects submitted, because the counties and the cities and so forth still had to submit the projects for funding. So the way we went about it was through developing specific safety plans for each of the state's 87 counties and each of MnDOT's 8 districts. Some of the concerns of implementing the systemic approach, some concern about, you know, these safety plans would come out with specific projects. They may not be in sync with what the agency's priorities are, limited engineering judgment, lack of political support. I'll just go to kind of how we overcame some of those. First, there's an acceptance that not everyone will buy into this approach, you know. We did a plan for all 87 counties to try to get as much buy-in as we could. Some of those have really implemented their plans. Others have kind of not done that so much. Include all stakeholders. One especially important one that we found is just the local elected officials. Really get them included in this whole safety plan process that we went through. Again, find agency champions to carry the banner. Demonstrate the benefits in practical terms. If you can really get people to see that bigger picture, that this systemic approach is likely to, especially on these rural and local roads, it's likely to result in greater reductions in these severe crashes than kind of the older approach that was really spot location focused. And a partnership between, I would say, federal highways, state DOT, and local agencies is important. Just a little bit, and I don't want to go into too much detail on our safety plan process, but you know, it was a fairly expensive effort to do a specific plan for all counties. $3.5 million is what we put into that, but we think we got out of it a lot higher quality HSIP projects, and $500,000 to do the DOT plans. And just quickly, the approach that went through, a lot of crash data analysis, you know, was the first step to identify where the problems, but also kind of try to understand what the risk factors are. Identifying emphasis areas similar to how SHSP would be done. Identify what proven strategies we want to target. We also did safety workshops to try to pull in another opportunity to kind of pull in enforcement, education, all the other partners, and get those more engaged at a local level. And at the end, what came out of this was, and that's how it's different than an SHSP, is these plans came out with very specific recommended projects for each county and each MnDOT district, where the location was, what the proposed project would be, and okay. So very quickly, I'm just going to go through. In these plans, we looked at intersection locations, segments, and curves, and I'm just going to kind of walk you through how we went through the curve analysis for these plans. So one of the risk factors that was identified was simply ADT. And if you look at the 500 to 1,000 foot or 1,000 ADT range, that range contained about 28% of this region's curves, but 59% of the severe crashes were occurring within that range. So basically from 500 to 1,500 for this particular area, those were flagged as higher risk in terms of ADT. Radii, kind of a similar process. We just looked at, kind of looked for the curve radii range where severe crashes were overrepresented and flagged those as higher risk curves. Visual traps, just simply a roadway alignment where, you know, the roadway is curving off to the left here, but the roadway and the horizon, as well as the tree and utility pole line, kind of confuses the driver, creates kind of a visual confusion there. So that was flagged as another risk factor. Just an aerial view of that. The presence of intersections along the curve, also identified as another risk factor. Yeah, these were some of this data. Someone mentioned, I think, as we were going around, what if you have data limitations? So some of our data, we were able to just use Google Earth and other aerial photo tools to get some of this information. We had the traffic volume data, even on the county system in Minnesota, but we didn't have, for example, like curve radii information. So we were able to use Google Earth and some simple measurement tools to measure those as accurately as was necessary for this analysis. So kind of then what came out of this, for this particular county, a total of 504 curves were looked at, but out of that analysis of all those risk factors, 32 were identified as being at most risk for a severe crash. So the ones that had anywhere from 3 to 5 risk factors identified with them. So that's I think another thing I'd point out was systemic. It doesn't mean a lot of data analysis isn't required. Actually, if you do it well, quite a bit of data analysis is required, but it really helps you target those higher risk locations and then just cover more of them with lower cost countermeasures. And I just want to mention this, that we also worked to try to streamline the process. I mentioned that some of the complexities of the federal process. But one thing we wanted to provide to the counties and the local agencies especially was just, this was just a simple summary sheet that came out for that was developed for them for the recommended projects. It had all the data basically that the committee that selects HCIP projects for funding needed to kind of look at each project and see if it was one that should be funded. So it's just another effort to streamline it and make it as simple as possible for them to basically take this page out of their plan and submit it very easily for safety funding. So there are some things like that I think you can do to kind of streamline the process. Just quickly go through here. So this is where our crash trend is going in Minnesota. Going back to about 2003, we're up in the mid-600s. We're running about 20 below 387 from last year. Our fatality rate is about 0.68, which is pretty good. I think Massachusetts actually has a better fatality rate than Minnesota, so I'd like to talk to you and give us some tips on how we can, because we want to keep ours going lower, so. Is that right? So it's the urban thing, huh? Okay. But anyway, we feel like this shift that we've made to a more systemic approach and also treating the local system doesn't explain all of this, but it's been a part of the success, I think. So, any comments or questions before I hand it back to Jerry? Yeah.
When you talk about the local projects, can you just give a little more detail on how those, they're administered? Are they administered by the state, or is money given to the locals to administer themselves?
Yeah. Basically, MnDOT will send out a solicitation to the local agencies saying, you know, there's so much money available in this solicitation, but it's still up to the counties to submit those projects for funding, which is why the plans kind of made that simpler and more streamlined for them. But then they're in charge of actually handling contract administration, construction inspection, and all that. One thing I would mention that they've done to kind of make that more efficient for them is they've sometimes bundled projects amongst a number of counties. For example, one I'm thinking of is delineating curves with chevrons. A number of counties grouped that into a much larger project, so they got lower bids. And then they just had one county that volunteered to handle construction administration on that project. And then they kind of just take turns with that sort of approach.
Thank you.
So, Jerry, there's one question over here.
Thanks. Actually, I had a question for John later, but mine's mostly a comment. When you were talking earlier about the importance of the educational programs like HSM and things, one of the things we're hoping next year to bring into Connecticut is HSM Lite. And I think those kinds of opportunities for local agencies are really the way to engage them, because local agencies look at the HSM and they're shaking their head. But I do think the programs that FHWA is developing to really try to get good information to them is kind of critical to be able to engage them in that process. Just a hint that we want it next year, by the way.
We got that request noted. So I mentioned, too, I know Will's partner, Mark Vasecki from MnDOT, who's given this presentation, too, mentioned it's helped some of their counties that have had some things that maybe their elected officials have been a little bit nervous about go forward, and even their public. You know, if you were doing a centerline rumble strip project on a certain county route, if it goes through six counties and collectively all six counties decide to do it, if you're the seventh county and your county is a little nervous about doing it, it's kind of strengthened numbers. They can hide behind, well, you know, this whole route's going to be done. Everyone sees the benefits here. My other five buddies that are right next to me are going to do it. That makes it easier for me to say yes rather than opt out. You know, if they were going to try to do that on their own, they'd probably never be able to do centerline rumble strips. So I think, too, the one thing I think Mark mentioned, too, is that through this process, someone asked a question one time about high crash locations, and I think they found that statewide, they found that their systemic analysis yielded, I think, two or three high crash locations on the state system that they would have normally identified under their normal process, and none on the county system. So it's really changed their whole philosophy on how to select projects. So very good. We're going to move on to the predictive approach, and we'll talk a little bit about Louisiana's experience in this. So as I mentioned, Betsy Tremonte nor April Renard could join us today, but I'm going to do my best to kind of go through some of this. So we'll talk about some milestones, and I really want to push their process of how they got into it. I think someone mentioned that not a lot of states have done much on the project development side, so I really want to highlight what Louisiana's has initiated. So we'll talk about their business practices and how they've changed some of those things, and what they saw as key benefits and key successful steps to implementation. So really, their effort began in 2010. Actually, John McFadden's counterparts in the Resource Center came and gave a presentation to top Louisiana Department of Transportation and Development's key leadership, and convinced them that this was worth getting into. And that happened in fall of 2010. They actually did some training at that point. Their state opted to get into the Lead State Initiative. I mentioned that before, that ASHTO has put together. They're also part of the FHWA's pooled funds study to implement the HSM. So fell into 2011. In 2011, they added the HSM implementation to their Strategic Highway Safety Plan, and they put it underneath their infrastructure area of emphasis area. And then again, that followed in 2012 with an implementation plan being developed. So they're just a few years into that implementation plan. That plan is a five-year plan for full implementation based on 2012 to 2017. So they're just getting into it. They actually formed an implementation team. And you see here, it's not just safety folks. They involved many, many offices in the Department of Transportation and Development. They also involved more folks in the FHWA division office. It wasn't just the safety person there. It was also their traffic operations and also planning folks that got involved. So, and of course, LTAP, that was a big one in their agency because they help with all the local roadways. So that's something you might think about too. So their training plan that they came up with is mandatory. It's mandatory for their DOT folks as well as their division office folks, but also the consultants. All the consultants that want contracts have to have had HSM training, and it requires in-person detailed HSM training, not online course or anything like that. So they really wanted to help implement this in their state. So getting into where they've included it in their applications for their project delivery process. The first one is stage zero is feasibility. That's basically when they're looking at a high level of projects, trying to figure out which projects and what their performance of safety has been on projects that, you know, through their capital improvement program, things like that. All projects in Louisiana have to go through a feasibility stage. And so that gets involved in there. Stage one is planning and environment. We'll talk about that as we go along. And also final design, that's another stage that they've gotten involved. So in stage zero, they're using the CMFs and predictive method to evaluate safety of various design elements and alternatives. They're trying to figure out the scopes of these projects as they go forward, what might be in consideration for alternatives. Stage one is their planning environment, as I mentioned. They're using the CMFs to predict and evaluate the impacts of each of their alternatives. And they actually included an example here. This is Interstate 12 to Bush roadway project. They actually used the IHSDM for this project. They initially started this project using the spreadsheets, the HSM spreadsheets that John mentioned, but quickly realized that these new alignments were going to be way too comprehensive to try and plug into spreadsheets. And so they went to the IHSDM at that point and got a lot of assistance from Federal Highway Administration through that process. So this project was they looked at four alternatives to replace a two-lane roadway with a four-lane divided roadway with controlled access. And so these were new alignments. You see here actually the alignment that was chosen, but they looked at the alternatives, including the no-build alternatives, to evaluate them, and safety was just one of their criteria. You see that information there, the crashes they expected to reduce, the cost of those crashes, which again is assignable, it's something your agency would look at, and then also what they saw the potential reduction in crashes to be. So they were able to quantify those safety benefits and impacts. And use that analysis as part of their decision tree. So in the end, the Corps of Engineers actually selected alternative Q, which had a predicted crash reduction of 6% and a $1.5 million cost savings to society. So if we go quickly back, you see here, alternative Q wasn't the best from the safety perspective, but it was decent. And again, we don't want safety to necessarily dictate your conversation, just to have a seat and be part of that matrix that you're using to make the decision. So in this situation, Q was the best from the environmental impacts as well as safety, and was the best solution for the decision. So in stage three, they look at final design. They use this for their design exceptions. As I mentioned before, they haven't really seen this changing their design exceptions necessarily, but it's helped validate their engineering judgment that their designers have been applying. So they've also used CMFs in their transportation management plans for those, you know, the work zone staging and how they're going to do construction, and it's really helped them in that area too. Some of that area is probably the least area where we have data, you know, about crashes as well as the setups that were out there. So that's an iterative process that will get better as they go, but it's something they're working on. So we'll look at some of the other business practices. There's been four offices that have basically been impacted by their HSM implementation. So highway safety, of course, has been the most. They're working on developing their calibration for their HSM safety performance functions. They're actually working on some specific safety performance functions for Louisiana right now. They've actually procured a software tool to help do their network screening, kind of similar to Safety Analyst, but different. It's a commercially available software product. They're developing SPFs, as I mentioned, and specific CMS for some of their situations they're dealing with, and also developing some guidelines for including in their safety and design policies. So transportation planning is working on guidelines for those stage zero feasibility studies. So again, it's a work in process. It's not something you have to have figured out on day one. It's kind of a chicken and the egg theory. You know, you got to kind of get going into this. I know Washington State DOT has also had the same thing. They've started implementing these different policies, and they say, hey, we know we don't have all the answers right now. To the extent possible, start incorporating the HSM. And that's actually on your thumb drive as well. As well as the I-12 to Bush study I mentioned before, that is also on your thumb drive. And we've got all the case studies we've talked about today are on that thumb drive. So they're environmental. I mentioned before they're including this as training is required for their consultants. They've included that in their scope of work too. So the consultants have actually been received this pretty well. They're getting paid for it, so they're okay with doing this analysis. I think they found it's been about 40 hours for each alternative that they've analyzed. So they are I think $25,000 per project is basically what they're adding for some of these alternative analysis to their projects. Also road design, I mentioned that for their design exceptions, and they've had training on IHSDM as well as ISAT-E tool. So they are very complimentary of the training they received from Federal Highways on that. So. Some of the benefits we mentioned about able to quantify the safety impacts, that's been something they've found refreshing because their management had been asking for it and quite honestly had gotten frustrated maybe that we could never answer those questions very good for them. Some of the keys to successful implementation, identify a champion and establish an implementation team. I think that's critical. Develop it and execute your implementation plan. That's going to be an iterative process and take some time, of course. Revise or develop agency policies and resources. Examine risk management and the legal issues. I can't speak too much to that. Assess data information. That's going to be an evolving process. You know, the more we start using these tools, the better our data is going to get. There's a lot of data initiatives that are out there as well. Develop your budget and phased approach. Identify what technical assistance you need. That's really going to help our team know what we need to do to help you respond. And consider organizational needs and issues that might come up as well. Some of the lessons they've learned, employ a consistent technical approach. They're trying to use this on all their projects. Again, go through a phased approach so they're always doing it the same way. Encourage gradual changes. You know, you're not going to leap in with, head first, as John was saying. We're going to dip our toe in and just start to use these things when we can. Anticipate and champion that culture change. It takes a while to explain these new concepts. Even nominal safety versus substantive safety is new for a lot of folks outside the safety arena. So manage your training. Make sure everyone gets training, but it needs to be training that's specific to them. You know, environmental training might be different than your design training that you bring in. Also, your top-level management training is probably going to be a lot different, so you want to make sure that's tailored to them. So any questions on the predictive approach? Including the highway safety manual, and about 20 slides is a lot to try and cover. So, but I applaud what Louisiana's done. They've been, very good to work with, and really, I think this has been a good process for them. They've definitely invested more time as they've gone along. So, all right, we're just about out of time. I want to quickly go through some resources. You guys heard about the STIC incentive program. You guys are probably more familiar with that than I am, actually. So you know how that works. We talked about the aid projects, million-dollar projects. Certainly what we're talking about here is eligible. I don't know if we're going to have a lot of million-dollar projects, but you might come up with something. Maybe there's something collectively that the northeastern states want to try. We'd be happy to hear about it. So there's that opportunity to increase your share. There's also a lot of resources out there. We talked about some of these, the HSM itself being pretty hard to digest. There are some implementation guides. There's one for managers out there. There's one for integrating HSM into the project development process. There's an HSM user's guide that's brand new. One that's coming out very shortly is integrating safety into the project development process. And you saw some of the case studies we talked about from Ohio and Arizona are actually in that manual, as well as on your sticks. So what we can offer is technology transfer as far as presentations, training, and peer exchanges. And our administration is really behind what we're doing here. So we're going to offer free technical assistance for any state that opts in, be it on the safety management side or the project development side or both, as well as a systemic or predictive analysis or both. So quite honestly, to be full disclosure, we haven't figured out how we're going to be able to deliver all this yet. But we want that challenge. If we have 50 states that come back and want to do this, we'll figure out a way to deliver it to 50 states. So again, we're helping you dip your foot into that water. We're going to walk you through that process. We're not going to give you a fish. We're going to help teach you how to fish. And so it's going to be a process that we hope can eat for a lifetime, if you want to follow that analogy. So. One of the things I do want to mention quickly, too, is that there is a process in January. At the end of January, you'll have an opt-in opportunity for all the different initiatives that you're looking at. So data-driven safety analysis is going to be just one of those 11 sheets, I think, that you'll have to discuss. For us, the more detail you can put in there about where you're at right now, where you'd like to get to in the two-year period, that's going to help us, as well as the activities that you might have in mind, if it's on the systemic side or it's on the project development side. The more specific can be, at least of your wishes, the more we can be able to respond once the new year starts, and so we can hit the ground running. So if you have other questions or have some ideas you want to run by us, feel free to send any of our team emails, and we'd certainly be happy to discuss those with you. So we're kind of excited about some of this. So again, these would be 100% funded, as at least the process that you went through. So we're excited about those opportunities. I mentioned these before that are out there. I did want to mention our team as well. We have the largest EDC team ever assembled. We have over 28 members, something like that. But it's because we're talking about two analysis tools on the state and the local system side, as well as the predictive and systemic approaches. So it is quite large, but many of them have helped us out through this process. And that is all I have for you today. So are there any questions at all left? Whether right here.
Rob Limoges, DOT in New York. I guess just kind of following up on my question before is, can you guys help us do like a gap analysis? Because at least in my state, I know I inherited some really good methodologies that have been developed years ago. And we have a big investment in our data system, a big investment in our policies and process and training. And we have to be careful about how we select to invest our resources and training new, basically re-engineering our process.
Sure.
So we want to make sure we're kind of focusing on where there's greatest need. Can you guys help us do that gap analysis?
That's a great question.
I'm talking about, we have, for example, our network screening process. I feel like it's pretty robust. What's the net gain if we kind of re-engineer our process to adopt highway safety manual methodologies? What incremental gain are we going to get when at the end of the day we want to do projects to reduce crashes? So, we kind of have to benchmark our current process versus this, state of the practice. Our practice.
Can we? The short answer, yes, we can help with that. I think what it would involve would be something we would want to come to New York and see what it is you have, how it's working. In no way am I, or are we saying philosophically, throw out everything you have and just use what we're promoting here. I think what we're going to see is, when I think of gaps now, there may be opportunities for areas that you are not so strong in predicting or applying systemic approaches that we can pull from what's here to complement the existing approaches that you're applying. Philosophically, that's the approach I think of. I think so too.
As the Office of Safety has two different programs. One's called the CDIP, the Crash Data Improvement Program. And there's also a RDIP, the Roadway Data Information Improvement Program. And we can actually come in and help do an assessment. And not that we're going to find some things maybe you don't know, but sometimes a fresh set of eyes looking at some things, yeah, maybe we'll help with that gap analysis. So I certainly would be interested in following you up with you on that and getting people a lot smarter than me that can help do that, involved in the discussion, because I think we can help you in that. So we'd definitely be interested in working with you and see what we can figure out. But I got to think there's an opportunity there. So that's a great question.
Has any state applied the design build process to the implementation of low-cost safety improvements?
Yes. I believe Missouri did quite a bit of that. And I know there's been some presentations on that where folks have used kind of a design build process for rapidly, treating some low-cost safety improvements. Yes. I think Missouri is one of the states that's done that. We can find some information on that, and my counterparts in headquarters are probably kicking me because I don't know the names of the states that have done it, but I think we even have some research projects that have been done that.
I think that South Carolina, with their intersection project, did sort of a design build with markings and signs and things like that.
Yeah, I will follow up with Karen Scurry, my counterpart in the Office of Safety, who's in charge of our systemic process. She probably has several examples. I think there was even a document written on it, but I don't want to quote it. But I think some of that is available. So, excellent. Other questions? All right, well, I want to thank you all for joining us. I know we went a little long. We got a little bit of a late start, so I appreciate your patience. If you have any questions as they come up, you have our contact information. We'd be glad to hear from you. And again, hope you consider data-driven safety analysis for all your highway investment decisions. Thank you very much.